Hello, everyone. Welcome to another Mix Tank Live with me. My name is Mark Abrams, and we are here on Puremix.com's Mix Tank Takeover. So today we're going to be reviewing mixes uploaded to our mix commenting platform, Mix Tank. It's available for all Puremix Pro members, and users upload their mixes so that they can get feedback from the community. And then every Monday, 2:30 p.m. Eastern, sorry, every other Monday, 2:30 p.m. Eastern, I go live and comment live on them, along with my good friends in the chat. Over here, I still haven't got the hang of this, but over here, everybody's in the chat and dropping comments as well. Their feedback is amazing, just as it is on Mixtank. So definitely, if you've submitted a mix, make sure you're checking out the chat to make sure that you see all the good stuff coming from the community. Good to see everybody here. We were off for a couple weeks, so nice to see you. Martin Smoking Fudo, Mike Ornsby, Christopher Strickler, Smoking Fudo, and everybody else, Six of One, of course, Paul Martin, good to see you guys all back, Brandon Crudel. Brandon, I saw your name pop up, and I'm hoping that you have a song in here, because your music always makes me think of summer. So, all right, so the way that this works is, if you guys are live, I like to try to get to everybody that showed up to the live stream first, and then if we have spare time, we go through some of the other submissions on Mixtank. But if you're live, let me know that you submitted the song over in the chat, drop the name of the song in your username, and we'll get to as many of these as we can. All right, to kick it off, Christopher Strickler said that he had one over in active here. And, oh, sorry, a little bit of housekeeping. Guys, Friday, another live stream's happening with Fab DuPont. He's going to be mixing the Motown, the recreating the Motown sound video that was done on Puremix, where they used all of the UA, the Hitsville stuff and like the Motown reverb. They use Sphere microphones with microphone modeling, and they tried to recreate the sound of a Motown track with Louis Cato and a bunch of other insanely good musicians. The mixing session for that is happening live this Friday, 2:30 p.m. Eastern on our YouTube channel. It'll be on Puremix and all the other places we stream. Hello, everybody over on Twitch. I never say hi to you guys, but hello. And Facebook as well, of course. So make sure you guys tune in 2:30 p.m. Eastern this Friday for Fab DuPont mixing the recreation of the Motown sound. It's going to be pretty crazy. If you haven't seen that video too, make sure you go check it out. They went down to as many details as they used to stuff the bass drum with shredded newspaper back in the day. So they, of course, did that. They didn't have the Detroit newspaper though, so they had to use the New York Times. You do what you got to do. Okay. I see Brandon Crudel's track right there. Okay, we're gonna start off with Christopher Strickler because I said we would, and then we'll come back. Let's see if I can find your name on here. All right. Maybe we'll Mixing the Cloud. I see one from YouTube. I'm gonna start off with Brandon Crudel. So guys, let me know your name of your track over in the session, and then we'll hit it. So here we go. I'm leaving.
Run or where to hide, babe, but I'm leaving. and I won't be coming back. If you want me to be your baby, then you better let me know. Time is short and time is a wasting. If you want me, let me know. I don't know what to do when it comes to you. So I'm leaving, and I won't be coming back. So I'm leaving, and I won't be coming back. When it comes to you, babe, so I'm leaving, and I won't be coming back. I'm leaving, ooh, I won't be coming back.
Very nice. Very, very nice. Mike Ornsby had a great comment in here. Keeping it stripped down to basics. I like it, which great comment, because I thought that as well. And also in your description of this, you said that your one issue is that you're struggling with the amount of acoustic guitar tracks. They all add a little bit, but the sum of them is giving me some issues. I dropped out two tracks on this mix that were double tracks. But the balance is just not right. So, and also you said that this is a rough mix. So another thing to consider there. So I think that you're on the right path with dropping out acoustics, because listening to it, I don't feel like there's too many parts. So you've done a good job with the arrangement. I didn't have that feeling going through it. The one thing is the one that's happening over on the right, he's just chugging along the whole time, like with the muted, you know, muted strumming pattern when he's not actually playing notes. And I think that that's causing some clutter. Like if that was gone, I think the whole thing would feel more calm. But there's things that we can do to address that. So my overall thoughts was the vocal. The first thing that stuck out was the mid-range. It's a little bit cloudy, like 400 or 500. Ish just feels a little honky overall. Some of that I think is from the compression, also some EQ stuff. Also, this is a rough mix. You're looking at balance right now, so you haven't addressed any of those things. So there it is. I heard it, but I don't know how much of an issue that is at the moment. Okay, and then the next thing is the guitars are for me at about the same level or just a little bit behind the vocal balance wise, and they're a little bit present, which is also causing some of the balance issue, is my guess. Like, so going back to my sort of the thing that I always kind of go off on here is about depth and thinking of volume and balance and all of that in terms of front to back, right? So the vocal is sitting about here for me. The guitar is sitting ever so slightly behind it, but sometimes poking out in front of it too. And it's not doing a lot of this, which is what you would have if it was not overcompressed. When you compress it more, things just kind of come up here and sit. So sorry about my hand motions. It's, again, this is a bat. This is the most important thing that anybody will see today. But if you have a bunch of compression the thing comes forward and it just stays there. If there's not a lot of compression, there's some breathing and some movement front to back, right? So I think that those acoustics might have a little too much compression on them as well, and it doesn't allow them to create depth with the vocal. That's my hunch on it. I don't know if that guitar is, if they were tracked with compression or not. If they were, my suggestion would be to use some expansion to try and get some more dynamic range, especially on that right guitar between where he's just kind of chugging along with the muted picking versus when he's playing notes, and see if you can get some more dynamic range in that so that he sits back a little bit when he's strumming and then like the notes are coming forward. I think that guitar calming down would allow the whole thing to breathe and make more room for everything. As far as the other balance stuff goes, some things that you could try, I would try two ways. I would try muting the guitars and balancing the drums and the bass with the vocal and make sure all of that is sounding great so that the whole drum kit and everything feels really good. There's some, you know, some definition that could be improved upon with like the snare drum and everything. I know that there's some congas in there, so you could play around with that, make sure all of that's feeling good. And then because those guitars are taking up so much space in the mix for you, bring them up into that and then see what you need to do to make them fit. If that doesn't sound right, because it's prioritizing, like the song is clearly based around the acoustics and the vocals. If that's not working for you, then I'd do the opposite. Get rid of everything else, back the compression off on the guitars. If there's mixed bus compression, back it off too. Balance the guitars and the vocals, which are probably the meat of the song, and then bring everybody else up into that. But try doing some fader down stuff, like just bring all the faders down and just bring it up, you know, bring up the most important elements, make them all work well together, then bring the candy stuff into it and make it all kind of fit. Just watch the overall compression, but overall, I think it sounded really good, especially for a rough, and I think you're on the way to it. So a lot of potential with this one. It's going to be really cool. So good luck to Lisa Walker, who you refer to as Granny. Good luck, Granny. Awesome. Thanks for submitting. Always great to hear a track from you. All right. The bat snare. I missed something in the chat. That's awesome. Yeah, not bad at all for a rough mix. That's crazy. Okay. Let me go up. So, Chris, sorry, I put a L in your name. It's Chris Stricker, not Strickler. So let me try this again. See if I can get yours on here. I can't remember your username on here. I'm very sorry. Okay. Christopher, if you're still in the chat, let me know your username on Puremix if you could, or the name of the song, and I'll track it down. I'm going to go to Mix in the Cloud, who I see in the chat, and I saw a song on here for. This is Joe's Bar, G1. All right, let's see. Notes are, this is an evolved impression of a cool song with a great groove. Climb in for a listen. Don't mind if I do. Here we go.
You gotta hold on me. You gotta hold on you.
Awesome. All right, I want to back up and just hear a little bit more of this earlier section, just about 30 seconds. Here we go. Cool. I was just checking to see if the snare changed throughout the song because I remember it being really nice and tight here. Okay, so great job. Sounds really cool. This is a cool song. And I don't have a whole lot. Let's see. There was a few things I heard in the drums mostly, and a lot of it has to do with compression, some low end buildup kind of stuff, low mid stuff going. And then opening up the vocal. So in particular, the background vocals I felt could be a little bit more full and come up. They felt a little bit thin. And then the vocal felt like the top could be opened up a little bit. It felt a little bit like it was under a little bit of a mask and it just needed a little bit of a lift. At first I was thinking like, oh, is it a little bit mid-rangey? But the mid-range sounds nice and balanced to me. It just sounds like it needs a little bit more air to it. So I'd see if you can get that without making a mess of your S-ing and all that stuff, but just the top end of the track could be opened up a little bit. The next thing that pointed, those were the two big ones for me. Like if you fix those, that would be awesome and great. Mostly the background vocals thing, just sounding a little bit thin and like they could kind of come up and wrap around the vocal a little bit more. The other thing was the kick drum was poking forward slightly to me. So when I think of that, so kind of another depth thing, but if we're looking at the speaker from the front and we turn to the side, so we're looking at the side of the speaker, sometimes when things are unbalanced from like the snap of the kick and the low end of it, I get this kind of impression, like the kick's leaning forward a little bit. So you got like the beater out here and then you got the meat of the drum that's kind of hanging out back here. And it's like the whole thing just kind of like tilts forward. Basically, the snap of it was just kind of poking out of the mix every once in a while to me. Sometimes it was balanced, like when the whatever compression you have on either the drum bus or the mix bus was catching it, it would feel good. And then every once in a while, it would just kind of like poke out forward to me and stick. Basically, when it would do that, if the vocal was sitting here, it would just kind of like stick out in front of the vocal a little bit. So, and again, this is a bat. The toms also jump out every once in a while, but honestly, like, a lot of times I'll get mixed revision notes from my clients being like, hey, you went a little crazy on the tom fill. Cause like, I figure if we're doing a tom fill, let's do a tom fill. Every once in a while, the toms jumped out like that to me. Like when I get comments from my clients or whatever, it's like the same thing that I do, but I like it though. So I'm just saying, there you go. And then the guitar solo felt like it was sitting a little bit behind the kick. So like the guitar solo needed to be a more important player whenever the solo section actually starts happening. And then the bass guitar, I think, is causing a lot of, I don't know if problems is the right word, but it's causing a lot of beefy muddiness down in the bottom of the track. So the bass guitar between like that 80 and 100 range, it just feels like it's getting really cloudy down there and it's kind of eating the kick drum, the low end of the kick drum sometimes, which could be why if you did an EQ move that boosted up the beater of that kick, it could be why you did that, because the bass guitar was just like down there having a buffet on the kick drum. I'd see if you can clear out some bottom end of that. Like there's just a lot of kind of like sub stuff rolling around there. So that could be a mixture of high passing, also a little dip, like 80 to 100 sometimes can make a lot of room for some things where if the track's feeling kind of like it had too much to eat, that's a good spot to kind of clear some things out. But yeah, overall, I think it's looking really good. So great job. Thanks for submitting that. Really appreciate it. Sounds good. Somebody said something about intermodulation distortion. I have a funny story about intermodulation distortion. I'll make this quick. One time I sent a track to a mastering engineer that the band I was working with, they really wanted to work with this guy. It was a friend of theirs. And they were like, we really want to work with this guy. So, okay, cool. You're the client. You choose the mastering engineer. So I send him the track and I get a note back and he says, hey, I noticed that there's some limiting on the mix, and I think I saw some intermodulation distortion. And so he said, like, can you take the limiter off and send it to me again? In this track, I used the limiter as a big part of the sound. So as soon as I took the limiter off, the balance changed, the snare was out louder and everything. I mixed in the limiter, it was part of the mix. And I called him and I just said, hey, like, just calling you about your email. To me, the limiter is a big part of the sound, so I can send you this one, but please do at least reference the track with the limiter to see what it was doing to the balance of the track. And he goes, oh man, you know what? Like, if you really feel like it's part of the mix, don't even worry about it. He's like, honestly, I didn't even listen to it yet. I pulled it up in Pro Tools. I was on the phone and I just looked at the waveform and saw that. I was just prepping it for tomorrow, so I haven't even listened yet. So just don't worry about it. I'll let you know if there's an issue. So immediately I told the band, you have to find another mastering engineer, because he sent a note on a revision of my mix based on what he saw on the screen, not what he heard. So there's my intermodulation story. There you go. All right, sorry for that little sidestep. Sidechain, Mixed in the Cloud asked, should I sidechain the bass guitar? You could try that. I would try just seeing if you can carve with some EQ there first and see if that works. And then if the bass guitar is still like just going nom 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 on the kick drum, then you could try and do a little sidechaining. So cool. Nice comment in there. Definitely check out everybody's comments in the chat as well. Very cool. Okay, so Chris Stricker, thanks again, Mixing the Cloud. That was fun. Okay, so C Stricker. I got it. Ever present. Here we go.
Faith lives on.
Okay, I just want to listen to one more section again. Stand by.
Searching for truth, I slowly lost touch. Then I heard a voice calling.
Okay, awesome. Thanks for submitting this, Chris. Very cool. I dig your logo, by the way. That's nice. Awesome. All right. So over in the comments for the track, Chris writes, I've written and produced this song in my humble home studio using Fiverr talent in England for lyrics and guitar work by Fiverr Pro. Norwegian guitarist Matthias Lund. I sent Matthias a rough mix from Pro Tools and he sent back 48K tracks of each guitar part ordered. So far, I've received incredible guitar work at a great rate, which could include some revisions. I haven't had to request any. That's an awesome commercial for Fiverr right there. And just want to like talk about that for a second. That's amazing. Like what we can do. I mean, the fact that I'm talking to you guys, to everybody's everywhere, all over the place, and we're listening to mixes that we've all uploaded to a certain spot. I don't mean to sound like an old guy, but this is awesome. It's pretty cool. And then he's ordering guitar tracks off of Fiverr. I have another client that he made his entire record. He's in Cincinnati. I'm in Columbus, Ohio. The band is literally spread out all over the world. The singer was from Australia. The drummer was in England. There was a guitar player in Spain. The mastering engineer is in Mexico. It's insane. And we do all of our mixing sessions over Zoom. It's crazy. Anyway, there's a billion people out there, and you can make music all over. It's really cool. Back to our regularly scheduled programming. For this song, drums and bass were created in Tune Track Superior Drummer 3 and Easy Bass. I did all the vocals and piano. I'm working on cleaning and editing the backing vocals. I did hear some drum issues toward the bridge. Fighting when the lead guitar comes in around 150. We're going to talk about that. I attempted to address using my limited knowledge of sidechain and Pro Tools using Isotope Neutron 4 on the lead guitar using an aux mono out to trigger the sidechain. That's thinking really hard about it. So we'll chat about that. And I think or hallucinate that I'm getting better at mixing drums and bass. I agree. I've heard your stuff in the past, and I think that you are getting better. But still probably overprocessing the vocals. This is a bedroom with standard ceiling, mixture headphones, monitor mixing. Okay, you do say at the end, using Easy Mix, Ozone 10, and Mix Aux. So we'll talk about that. My first thing is that I feel like there's a lot of ozone on this. I hear a lot of ozone. The whole mix feels very compressed, very loud, and it's really just smushing everybody down. And I'm hearing it a lot on the drums as well. I do think your drums sound really good. They're nice and present, they're clear, but there's a lot of compression on them. They feel like they're just taking up a lot of space and very just like anxious. They're really anxious because of all of the compression on them. It's just kind of bringing up all this energy that feels very tight. And the song, I think you have a beautiful melody on the chorus when you're singing Ever Present. The song to me is just kind of like this floaty, relaxed thing, but the drums feel like there's a lot of tension because of all of that compression there. So I would consider backing off some of the processing on the drums and then looking at the balance of them. Mixing great sounding drums, it's so easy to turn them up too loud. When your thought is, I want the drums to sound great, you end up turning them up too loud. And the drums are not there to be the star of the show. Your beautiful, like, the singing, the melody is gorgeous, the guitar playing is really good. Let that stuff shine and tell the drummer to chill out and, like, not do the Tommy Lee thing and sit back a little bit so that the track can just kind of breathe overall. That was my biggest thing, was just, like, everything felt really hyped and processed. That stuff's there to help you. It can really blow up your mix pretty quick. So that's the first thing. Overall, I think that things are sounding really good. And even the balances outside of the drums, I was trying to like ignore the drums and listen to the balances happening in the instruments. I thought that was really good. Just the drums are a little bit loud, but they sound really good. So the vocals sound a little bit telephone-ish to me. So like they're thin, like they've just kind of been rolled off from the bottom and from the top, and there's a focus around like the 2K range, 1K, 2K. And as an effect, I like it. And they could even work in some parts of the song as like an effect thing. But overall, like it's a little just over compressed and a little thin. So I checked that out. One second. All right, sorry. At 138, when the solo comes in, I think there's a resonant frequency in that solo guitar. It sounds like about 3K. It almost sounds like feedback if you're trying to hone in on it. And I wouldn't go crazy with taming it. Like you're talking about honing in on the sidechain with Neutron 4 using an aux mono out to trigger the sidechain. So I think that that's probably thinking too hard about it. And you could probably just go in with an EQ, like a Pro Q3, and do a tight band right around that resonant frequency and just bring it back. Soothe can also tame stuff like this, but for something like this, it would probably just start doing a bunch of stuff around it too, and this is a very narrow problem. So I would do just any EQ that you can solo the band, the stock one in Pro Tools, you can do this. Find out where that resonance is. It'll sound like feedback when you hit it, and just dip it out pretty hard, tight Q on that, and I think that'll help out a lot. Awesome. You say you have hearing loss at 2K. I don't think that you have complete hearing loss at 2K, and it wouldn't be that sharp. So don't worry about that too much. And also, don't let the hearing loss thing rumble around in the back of your brain too much. I'm not an audiologist, but I do know that our brains adapt to it. And even with some hearing loss, it's still possible to do a great job at this. So don't overthink that too much, or don't worry about it too much, or don't let it bum you out, I guess. It's all good. Okay, cool. Please let me know if you have any questions. Other than that, that was the main stuff that I heard. But Chris, I've heard other stuff from you, and I think that this is an improvement. This is really cool. So congrats. You're definitely making some progress. It's really cool. Mix in the Cloud says, mix over Zoom? ? So that's in reference to what I was saying about mixing over Zoom. So the way that I do that, Mix in the Cloud, is I get on a Zoom with my client, and I share my screen, my Pro Tools screen, so they see me, they see Pro Tools, kind of like a Puremix video, and then I send the output of Pro Tools to them using Audio Mover's Listen To plugin. So that's a really good way to do it. Another great way is SessionWire. SessionWire just had a huge update, and they manage your talkback mics and everything. So everybody, if you haven't looked at SessionWire in a while, they're doing some really cool things right now, and you should go check it out. That's SessionWire.com. I had a demo of it from them last week, and it's really rad, and it's probably going to end up replacing my Zoom and Audio Mover's workflow. But good work, good way to work. Okay. Let's see. Let's go to... So just to let everybody know who I've got on my list here. D-Pen, I see you. That's drifting away. Okay, so I have Creation of Life from Studio Jaman. That's going to be next. I have Nobody's Fool But Yours from Mike Conway. I have Paul Martin, Tony. I have Phantom and Flandy Bob and D-Pen. So guys, if I didn't just list you, please put your track and your username into the YouTube chat and we'll hit it. All right, next up, we're going to hit Studio Jaman. Always excited to do one of your tracks. He writes so much music. I love it. Okay, here we go. Thank you. What do you say? That's amazing. Great job, dude. My gosh. The composition is absolutely incredible. And same thing, like I'm hearing, I don't know, your mixes are getting better for whatever that means. It feels great. It feels really good. I have a couple comments, but it feels really good. I just want to listen back here to the first movement compared to the last movement real quick, just to hear something. Here we go. Okay, awesome. Man, it's so great. Great job on the dynamic throughout the song. So, as always, I agree with everything that Tom said in his comments. I have a couple more things to add to it, but I feel like he nailed it. Yeah, just at the end, there's it's getting a little bit too loud at the end. There's a little bit of clipping happening, it seems. Or it's hitting something a little hard. Just when it gets to the loudest section, should just taking the whole thing and going, yeet, might help out on that. That's a technical term. Yeet. Okay, so first section, I agree with everything that Tom said about the stereo-ness of things. However, you're very good at doing stereo, so I think that you'll figure that out just fine if you decide that you want to. And it I thought he was right about like things could be a little bit wider or a little bigger. I didn't feel that the center was cluttered, but I did think like you could expand on the immersiveness of it, as he put it. The kick drum felt a little loud to me, but it, he's right that it has a cool weight. So that's a taste thing. You just decide what you like there. And I was so into the thing that I forgot to read your thing over on the right. These are two separate movements in this piece. I thought there were three. The first is creation of light. The second is water is life. After several attempts at earlier versions, some great advice, especially from Tomfoolery. Decided to remix. You have another different starting piece. Awesome. Second half, same. Okay, so the other things that I had, the cymbals at the end felt a little too loud and harsh to me. They every time they hit, it was like, oh, which also feels like a wave, and you're talking about water is life, so maybe you want them to be that loud. If so, check out, you know, kind of like the pain regions between, like, you know, 3K, looking at 4K, 4.5K, just the stuff that kind of hurts if you have it too loud. Turn it up, whatever you're listening to, a little bit, you know, as loud as you would if you're really jamming, and just see if those cymbals are hitting you a little hard. For me, they're a little bit bright, a little harsh. Maybe not bright, but harsh, and only on the impact. So I would just do something, if you're going to leave them at that level, see if you can just take down the threshold of pain a little bit there. It's not that bad, so I'm not trying to make a huge thing about it. Just you know, maybe a little dip would help around that area. The drums are a little thin or roomy sounding to me in the last half of the song. It's also a taste thing too. The guitar at the end that was doing the more single note arpeggiated thing, I think, if I'm remembering it right, that could use just a touch more low mid, just meat to the song. But my biggest thing for the end of it, I feel like you have a nice, nice, like full low end range in the first half of the track. And then in the second track, I'm missing, just something occupying that, like that lower sub region, or, like a bass, either a synth, bass synth, or a bass guitar or something, just taking care of the low end duties, on that second half there. So adding something like that might take care of where I was thinking the guitar sounds a little bit thin, but you might also be able to fill it out. The other thing is with the drum sounding a little thin or roomy there, if you add a big low end, like if you had a bass synth or something like that, probably wouldn't fit the vibe because the drums are not punchy and delivering their own low end like that. So it'd probably just eat up the drums for lunch. So I don't know. Maybe it's fine. But that was a hell of a ride. Thank you so much for submitting that. And I'm so excited to hear what you do with Atmos. It's going to be pretty crazy. And I think like with your stuff and your mixing style too, I've been doing some mixing in here, and I think like you starting your mix in Atmos and then crashing it down to stereo is going to yield some pretty cool results. That would not work for me, but it would definitely, like, it would be interesting to see what would happen with you, because you do a lot of widening and all of that. We've talked about this before, like a lot of widening to get that immersive feel, and these feel great. And I didn't hear anything that felt really phasey on this one either. Just so you know, so really cool. But yeah, I think it'd be interesting to see what happens there. So thank you for submitting, as always. It's great. And good job, Tom, too, because great comments. Okay. So next up, Mike Conway. Here we go. Nobody's fool but yours. Here we go. Thank you. Awesome job, Mix. Mike, sorry. Awesome job, Mike. But we'll just call you Mix. Awesome Mix Mike. There we go. That was some kind of version of what I meant to say. Okay. As previously mentioned, I usually agree with tomfoolery and a lot here as well. So let's talk about the drum kit balance first. So as Tom mentioned, the snare's a little bit loud and... for me, it's a little boxy sometimes. So just that kind of mid-range, like poking out a little bit, just getting a little bit cloudy. And the volume of it. So again, I'm going to talk about the depth thing. This is how I kind of think of balance. And the snare, you know, if this is our vocalist, our snare depth-wise is sitting in front of him. So that's how I hear when I'm listening to the song. I hear the snare in front of the vocal. And for this kind of track, I would do the opposite, and I, you know, it's up to you if, how you want to place that, but, I definitely hear the snare out front, which, tells me the drums are the star, and the kick drum, every once in a while was kind of feeling the same way. At the top, I felt like the bass guitar was eating the kick drum. Let me just double check that, because I think it got better toward the end of the song. So it might stay kind of static, but there's something going on in the relationship of the bass and the kick that feels a little bit off. Like either there's too much compression on the bass, but they're not kind of gelling well together. So yeah, just that relationship between the two. Make sure the bass isn't eating the kick. It didn't feel like it was eating it there to me. I felt like I still had some punch. Let me listen one more time to be more clear on this.
I love you, pretty baby, but I can't love enough for two. I love you, pretty baby.
Okay, so the bass guitar is a little bit loud to me, and then I feel like you've done some things with the vocal because the bass is taking up so much mid, low mid range, that you've scooped the vocal and you're giving it more of a high range presence, high mid presence, which is causing that peaky spot that Tom's talking about between the 3 and 5K area. I hear that as well. And I also hear something that maybe an octave of that, where it's just kind of like there's too much shine, almost like if you do too much, as if there's a thing for it. But if you do too much of the high band on Sugar, it can start kind of sounding like this. I almost hear that kind of sound happening. So like too much excitement at the very top of the vocal. So there might be some more even tone that you can find with the actual vocal of it. And then that might inform what you need to do with the bass guitar, the kick and the snare as well, just balance wise, to try and get everybody to kind of sit a little bit better. I think that this is sitting really well overall though. So it's not like it needs a ton of work thing. It's just like a little cleanup on the vocal, figuring out some things in the bottom range, and then some balance things between the bass, the snare, and the kick. But the solo section at 3:45, the drums, again, so the guitar solo is happening, but the drums feel like they're out in front of the solo to me, which tells me I should be listening to the drums, not the guitar solo. So again, just watch out for that. The vocal ad-libs at 3:50, they're cool, but they're not as exciting as the guitar solo to me, so I would automate them back a little bit, like almost like the singer stepped away from the mic, the guitar player is singing it, he played something that the singer liked, and the singer just kind of like did a thing because he liked the guitar solo or something, but he wasn't really standing next to the mic, so that might be kind of cool. And same thing, B3 ad-libs at the end, I think that those are all awesome. I would automate them a little bit. There was the beginning of the little lick that he was playing was a little quiet, and then there was a part where he popped out of the mix, so might need some more automation there. Cool. Hope that helps. Awesome song, Mike. Very cool. Juan says, can you comment on Sugar? I assume you're talking about a Sugar, like the song, and not our plugin, but I'm not sure. Busted on Sugar. Nice. Sugar is amazing. It's easy to overcook it because a dabble do ya, as they say somewhere they say that, I think. I've heard that. Like a dollop or whatever. Anyway, okay, so Sugar. I think that's a song. Let me just see one, and then I'll add it to the list if so. Sugar. It is. Okay, that's a song from Juan. Okay, so Juan, I'll add this on here. So Sugar from Juan. I will definitely get to that. Let's see. Up next, we got Paul Martin. I wasn't sure if you wanted me to talk about the plugin or about your song, so we will definitely talk about this the song. Or the plugin if you want to, but I thought you meant the song. All right, Every Single Penny from Paul Martin up next. Mike, thank you. Let me know if you have any more questions on that. I hope it's useful. I think you're sitting in a really, really good spot, just a couple little things, and it's awesome. So, cool. Here we go.
All your money, I want it all, every single penny.
All right, I'm not a relationship therapist, but Paul, watch out for this woman. Just saying, she's a little needy. Here we go.
Just the other day, I was selling you things you did not need. Just the other day, I was selling to you, appealing to your goddamn greed. I want your soul, I want all your money, I want it all. other day I was stealing from you, stealing from your hard-earned pay. Just the other day I was stealing from you, stealing while you looked the other way. Give me your soul, give me all your money, I want it all, every single penny. I could easily tell you what all of this means, but if I was to tell you right now, I'd forever haunt your dreams and truth remain unseen. I want your soul.
Awesome. Very cool, Paul. A really good song, too. This is pretty fantastic, which it seems like you are producing this because it says in here you wanted to make the percussion a little bit more interesting and cover more of the frequency spectrum. So you raided your daughter's toy box and used the triangle, claves, and finger cymbals. That's awesome. The percussion's sounding great, and I think the production on this overall is really, really cool. I love the Wurlitzer. I love the guitar tone. All of that's awesome. Very few things on this. You did say in here that you're using a guide vocal on there. One, I think the vocal's really good. She was very compelling, and I was glued to what she was saying. Mostly because I'm worried about you. I'm worried about you because she sounds like it's just gonna be a one-sided relationship. I don't know. Maybe that's beyond the breadth of what I'm supposed to comment on here. All right. So back to things that are what we're here for. The balance between the guitar and the Wurlitzer. So the electric on the left is awesome. The tone's amazing on it. And even at the level that it's at sometimes, I think some automation is going to be really, really useful for you to make that guitar present and be where it needs to be, but also back it off sometimes so that the vocal can take the front seat or the Wurlitzer can take the front seat. So for example, the Wurlitzer solo, the guitar was much louder at around 2 minutes than the Wurlitzer was. The Wurlitzer also felt like it could use a little bit more presence, or like it could open up a little bit and just kind of come forward. So that would be another thought there. And the percussion felt a little bit bright to me. And overall, the mix feels a little bit hyped, almost like if you had a tilt EQ and it was tilted toward more brightness. It just kind of feels like there's a lot of excitement going on, some like harmonic stuff happening like in the 4K to 10K range, that kind of stuff is just kind of being lifted a little bit. So that might be a little overcooked if there's a processor doing that. Or you could try just some mix bus EQ and play with the shape of the mix. I would do that as an exercise too, just do a save as and play with the overall balance of the mix, just seeing like, oh, this is what like a more low mid present mix feels like, and then there's my brighter high presence mix, and you know, just kind of play with the shapes of that. I think that that's a great exercise and can kind of hone you in on that. But mostly my comments are around balance, and again, like I feel, you know, a lot of what Tom's comments are good. The vocal does feel far back, but again, I feel like that's a lot, that has a lot to do with the guitar on the left being too loud. So yeah, play around with it. At times, I do think it's cool with that volume. I just think automation is going to be necessary there. So cool. All right. I hope that that helps, and good luck with the singer. And awesome. Okay. Oh, cool. Nice. This is an updated mix from a few months ago. Nice. Paul says, I think I need a relationship therapist after working on these songs for so long. Yeah. Nice. Okay. All right. I had to work on one that was, last week I was working on a song with a band that it was so heartfelt. It was actually hard for me to get through it. It was like comic relief was definitely necessary in that session, 'cause it was a heavy song. Okay. Next one up is going to be Brand New Day. And guys, I see you over in the chat. If you've dropped songs, I see GSS and, let's see. I think I had you on there. Let's see. If ever I love someone. Nice. Okay. So if ever I love someone, I got you on the list, GSS. Let's see. And I'm watching the chat. So you guys post your songs and yell at me if I miss them. Renegade, Smoking Fudo. I have that one. Yep, we're good. All right. Here we go with Tony's. Excited to hear this.
I know what you've been doing, I've been doing it too. Keeping the distance was the right thing to do.
Okay, I want to listen to something right here.
Everything's changed.
Okay, I want to point this out, because in your comments you say I'd appreciate any suggestions on how to improve the mix, the song, or any other thoughts you may have. So, we'll talk about the vocal. That's one thing that I think you're struggling with in this so far. We're gonna listen to the end of the song too. Sorry to stop here, but I want to point something out. It's as one of the other songs earlier on Mixtank, it felt like things were a little bit cluttered in the center, or not using the full width of the stereo spectrum, right? Of the stereo width. You could spread things out more, basically, right? So listen to this riser. The riser is nice and wide and it feels really exciting. And then when the drop happens, the main instruments are kind of all parked in the middle. So check this out.
Everything's changed. It's a brand new day.
So one more time.
Everything's changed. It's a...
So it gives the illusion that like we had this big riser and then things got smaller. So we'll come back and talk about that in a second. Here we go. Okay, Tony, also, your mix is not really bad, and the song is not really bad, and nobody needs to go get a coffee. If anybody went to get a coffee, I'm going to come and find you. I'm just kidding. But Tony, seriously, it's not that bad. This is cool, and yeah, no need to apologize to anybody. This is what we're here for. This is awesome. Okay, so going back to what I was saying about widening things up. So we have this nice big riser, it's nice and wide, and then we go into the chorus and things kind of come in and get a little bit tinier. So ways that you could adjust that with the synths, obviously panning is great. Do panning as much as you can. Some of those things sound like stereo patches. So if you have a stereo patch that's feeling very mono, one thing I like to do is use Micro Shift from Sound Toys. If you don't have that, no worries. You can also do what's called the Haas effect. So somebody help me out in the chat with the actual values for the Haas effect. But basically, you use two very short delays on each side, slightly offset from each other, and that'll create a sense of width. And you would put this, basically, if you created a aux return, did a send to that aux return, and then put either Micro Shift or doing like a Haas effect thing on there, and then send some level into that, you're going to have a wider signal happening on just that fader. So generally what I'll do is create that with Micro Shift, and then I'll just blend up the Micro Shift fader to get the width that I want from the sound. And I think that will help out. I don't see anybody dropping Haas effect, but we're on a delay here too. So, yeah, so that's one way to do it. Short delays. I'm trying to think of some other plugins that do this that you might have, like any, maybe even a chorus plugin would help out with it, but just do some things that you can get some width out of it. I think there's a plugin called Wider from Polyverse Music that might be free. That one works really well. That would I just put on an insert, but yeah, so that's something I would look at. Next thing, I just want to listen to the chorus here again at the end. So with the dance kind of feel like this at the end there, I would want a little bit more snap and pulse from the kick drum as well. So doing, you know, maybe looking at the low mid range and pulling a little bit of that out and adding some snap in the like 4K ish, you know, finding wherever that's going to be on that particular kick drum. See if you can get some of the sort of bloat out of the kick drum and then add a little bit of attack so that we can hear like a nice tight kick drum that's moving the beat along. If it's just kind of going like woof, 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 it doesn't feel like a pulsing drive as if it's like a, you know, kind of a sound or whatever. So that's something that's genre specific to this kind of music, and I would consider doing something like that. Dimension D's, Roberto Chiga says that Dimension D is fantastic for this. That one will definitely help. Cool. And, oh, cool. You know, yeah. So the vocal feels overprocessed. Like you said, you're trying to make it sound big, but it comes out overprocessed. I actually feel like the vocal sounds a little bit small. At times, I think the vocal sounds really, really cool when the synths and everything are going on. And it's like at the end of the song, it almost feels like a small telephone style thing where like it's bandpassed and it's tiny and moving around a little bit. It's not taking up the whole spectrum because you've trimmed it down. But for sections like the verse and stuff like that, if you want it to sound big, I would actually try removing all of the processing that you have. And unless the microphone was very small sounding and, you know, had a high pass on it and all of that, you should have a big sounding vocal to put on there, and then do like minimal processing to control it. So deal with problem frequencies, use compression to even things out, but it doesn't need to, you don't need to like boost up the low end to make it overhyped or anything like that. I don't know. I've gotten vocals that sound like this, and when I see the session, there's usually like the Slate virtual mix rack has these presets on it that just obliterate sounds like ruthlessly. It's criminal, crime against sound or something like that. But sometimes those preset things can be a little heavy handed. So I would check that out. And like, I'm trying to think of what the ones are, but this has that sound to me, almost like it was that plugin, but I don't know that. Okay. Smoking Fudo says, if you listen to mono, there's some phase cancellation for that. So check it out. Haas Effect, correct me if I'm wrong, duplicate the mono track and delay about 30 milliseconds one of the tracks. Yeah, you can do that. As you decrease the decay time, the echo will slowly morph into a single sound, but with added stereo information. Correct, Martin. Yeah. So, yep. Yeah, Martin has the explanation on there. And if you listen to mono, there's some phase cancellation for that. Yes, there can be. Yeah, it's a quick, easy trick for WIB. So yeah, check out the chat for the Haas Effect comments that's happening up here. If you guys can read that. I've got this whole thing on a tiny little iPad here, so I can't tell how legible that is. Okay, let's move on to our next song. Great job, Tony. It sounded really cool, and I hope we get to hear another mix of it. Very cool, though. Keep at it. It's going to be awesome. Okay, next one up is Ray Lixer, and then after that's going to be Smokin' Fudo. Here we go. This is Goblin's Dance from Black Rabbit. Nice. Is this the right song? This doesn't say Moonlight Dance or Ray Lixer. Try again. Moonlight Dance. There we go. From Ray, here we go. HD. I'm just going to say this comment here so you can think about it while I play the rest of it. But I got really used to that upright driving the song. And then the Wurlitzer came in, kind of loud, kind of present, and right on top of the bass. And it's just kind of putting a mask over the bass and saying, like, listen to me. So one thing I would consider here is panning the Wurlitzer off of the bass, just so we still have the upright and the Wurlitzer isn't sitting on top of it. You also have something amazing happening in stereo right there. I love it. So just wanted to add that while we keep listening here. Here we go. check in the beginning here. So the only other thing, the kick feels substantially louder than the bass to me, and it's a little bit heavy on the bottom end, so it could be a monitoring thing, potentially, so watch on headphones and everything. And then overall, it feels like there's a lot of compression on the mix. Things are feeling, again, very anxious, very excited. So watch out for just making it too loud as well. I don't think that this is a track that needs to be loud, and I think dynamic range is your friend here, especially when those big hits happen. Like, you know, you can make that beautiful and open. Doesn't need to be overexcited or like a lot of parallel stuff on it. This one, this is funny, I keep on calling out plugins here, but this feels like what happens when you put God Particle on something and there's a lot of parallel compression brought up with it. Not saying that's what you used, but that's how it kind of feels. And yeah, I'd say just watch out for volume on things. The Wurlitzer jumps out a lot to me sometimes, so that could use a little bit of control. If you still have access to dealing with the distortion on it, I think the distortion is making it a little bit honky. So maybe backing that off a touch would allow the Wurlitzer to breathe a little bit, but it's also a vibe thing, so I totally get it. That's just a thought. Very cool. And Christopher asked, would you still keep the bass centered? I was actually thinking you could pan the bass off a little bit on this one. Normally I would keep the bass centered. I like my bass to be in the center. But on a jazz track, I would play with that. So yeah, sure. Like the bass could totally move. If it doesn't feel too crazy for you, that might be an option. That's an interesting idea for him, Christopher. Let's see. Yeah, very cool sounding track. It's awesome. And let's see what else. D-Pen, I got you on the list. Definitely. Yeah, I love the groove as well. And who doesn't love a Wurlitzer? Awesome. Okay, very cool track. I definitely dig it. Let me see if there's anything else toward the end here. Yeah, I dig what you're doing with the trumpet too. It's very far back, and as long as you're cool with that, like, which you are because you made it that way. Yeah, I don't notice the trumpet as an instrument, but more of as a sound design choice. But I think it's a cool vibe. So there you go. Awesome. Really cool track. Definitely like that one. Thanks for hanging out. Okay, let's do... I got Smoke and Fudo, and then D-Pen is up after that. Here we go. Renegade.
Oh,
Awesome job. Again, I agree with a lot of what Tom said on here. So the first thing he said, the bass seems a bit too boomy and it seems the guitars have too much bite. I wanted to give a big kick, but to tame boominess, I probably overused a multi-band compressor. So I do hear a lot of compression happening in this overall. It's kind of giving that unpleasantly tight feeling. And I know this is a rock song and we want that energy, but it feels like there's a little bit of overuse of compression on it. So where that's kind of causing issues, I think like what Tom said about the 250 to 300 hertz area, I'm hearing a lot of that on the drums, and I think that you hear it pretty well at the end there. It's like the compression is, it's just kind of taking all the pop out of the drums, and then it's almost making them sound a little bit woolly or woofy in the, like in the snare and all of that, like that 300 stuff is all kind of kicking up from the compression. So I'd check that out. And that would be the first thing I would deal with if I was doing another pass of this, is just loosening that up and seeing what it does to the drums overall and the balance of the track, because they might start popping out. The guitars, I kind of get what you're saying about the bite thing. They're not crazy, but it feels like there's some processing that is also kind of having an effect on that there. Let me know maybe what was going on with the guitars. If you mean bite is in the CLA plugin, I could see that, but that's really me guessing there. Okay. Other than that, I agreed about the vocal. I thought that that sat really well. If you feel like you're losing some words, I would maybe go through and just hit those, but the vocal level was very nice. Let me just listen to one more part here. 1 second. Treat you like a renegade. If it's all right, it's all right. I only treat you like a renegade. If it's all right, it's all right. Okay, so right through this section here, another thing I thought that you could do is... we can't have things be super huge and wide without being small and more, you know, into the middle, if you will. So I was thinking too, like the, when it's doing that buildup with the bump, 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 ba-dum, bump, bump, that part could be panned in a little bit. So the guitar that's far left doing that, that guy can move in a little bit. And then when it gets to the drop, with the big open chord, if that went back to full width, you'd have this big open, like, it'd be amazing. It'd be super wide. One day I'm going to like end up seeing a comp reel of all of my dumb expressions, and it's going to be very embarrassing. But yeah, so thinking about that, let's listen to that one more time. Also, this guitar happening on the red, I want to hear more of that, the bendy thing that's like kind of helping the build and balancing out the staccato guitar on the left. So I think that would help. The bass guitar is very muddy to me as well. So I didn't really even think about the bass guitar much until that pass, because it's just kind of hidden back there. It feels muffled, like it's just a bit of subbiness, and it's just kind of like being very like just kind of floating on the bottom with a bunch of sub range. So mid-range is awesome on rock tracks like this. 800, 1.6K, both are great points to bring up some of the nose of the guitar and get some mid-range presence out of it. Also obviously helps with translation of small speakers. I would definitely look at adding some of that to this bass guitar. Too much, you know, 1.6 can get a little clacky. 800 has the body, but if you're not getting it there, you can get the definition at the octave point up at 1.6 or thereabouts. You can obviously slide that around. It's not true for everything. So yeah, cool. CLAs, 3As, yeah, awesome. I can hear what you're talking about. Like, yeah, lead guitar too suppressed to me seemed to be something interesting at the end. Yeah, I agree. That was the thing on the right, I think. And yeah, just watch out for the compression on those guitars, and that might help with the bite thing. Overall, though, I feel like this is really cool. I just try loosening the compression, see if that helps out a lot. And there's a lot of other good comments going on in the chat. Ray Elixir on the last track, there was an amp sim, but built in Keyscape, which is where it's coming from. Awesome. Ray, on that Keyscape thing, see if you hit the amp less hard, if that does anything cool for you or not. I like the tone, and I get where you're going with it. Maybe like a hair less would feel cool on that. I remember that one. Cool. Thanks for submitting, Smokin'. Very cool track. And let's move on. So Deep End, Drifting Away. So much good stuff on here all the time. It's really fun. I think every single week that I've done this, which we're going on 6 months now, I look up at the clock and I'm always amazed at what time it is, because it's never painful. Like, the music's always so good on here. This is awesome. Just, we have a sweet community. Okay, here we go. I love that bass sound. That's super cool. Awesome job. Deep End, this track's really awesome. I think I remember you posting something from this project before too, and just being touched by what you're doing with this stuff, which really, really cool. Good to hear another track from it. So once again, I agree with Tomfoolery. Maybe we should just have Tomfoolery take over, because he's always spot on. What else can you say? It's Tom. Deep End, you wrote, in 2010, I finished this production. I remastered this some months ago as I had the mix down. I've managed to save most of the project so I can also work on the mix some more. But what are your thoughts? Is there anything that pops out that I can work on the mix down or on the final master maybe? Thank you for your time. And then Tom wrote, 2010 was a long time ago. And in terms of your audio skills, I bet it feels like it was a lifetime ago. He says that because it was almost a lifetime ago for Tom. I'm just picking on him, but not really. He is not 13 years old. At least I don't think he's 13 years old. So I agree with him, though, that is a long time and for your skills to develop and everything. And I would definitely consider doing another mix of this with what you've learned. I think that this song is definitely worth it. I think the project's worth it, and it would make sense. Tom is Tomfoolery. Tom is he works with Puremix. He mixes all the videos that you guys see on the site. He does like the post-production mix. He's amazing. Tom is awesome. And he's also Fab's assistant. So he knows his stuff for sure. But yeah, Deep End, I think that this is definitely worth revisiting the mix on and seeing what you could do with it. I like the track a lot, and I'm sure that you've learned a ton from it. The main thing I agree again with Tom is the clap is super loud, and it might be cool to look at the production again and see if there's something you could do to break up the redundancy of the clap sound. Maybe it's a snap in some sections and it goes back to a clap in other ones, or it's layered with something else, but the clap is the same level for the entire song and it's very loud, so that feels a little redundant by the time that we get to the end of it. So I'd definitely take a look at that. And I don't think that that's something you would do in mastering. So in my opinion, the song is worth taking another look at the mix on. And I would use this as a rough mix. So, you know, you'd have this as a backup or, you know, as a reference point while you're going through it. So definitely take a look at that. I think it'd be really cool. And thanks for posting this. It's cool to hear another song. All right. The only thing that's harsh for me, I saw your comment, it's loud, but it's not harsh, right? It is harsh to me. The claps are harsh. If the claps weren't so loud and so compressed, I feel like it would be less harsh. They feel like they have a slow-ish attack, and it's like all transient getting through, or as though like there was a transient designer on it that was like the attack just turned up really high. Other than that, I don't feel like it's too loud or harsh. If you deal with the clap, it'll be less harsh. But again, I think like it'd be interesting to see what would happen with the mix. If you don't do a mix, the bass sound is really cool. There's some phasey things at points. It might need a little bit of a high pass filter to control some of the ultra sub stuff in mastering. But yeah, I don't know. I think like a mix would be pretty cool on it. Yeah, let me know if you have any more questions on that one. And we'll move on. All right, next one is from Phantom. This is called Come in the World. Here we go. Aku Fen, as he's known on Puremix. Mm-hmm.
which the confused who we are. Just two seas down deep in the unknown, only from halt and drown. They are the rough and the grind, all the things that go well behind.
Couple things to listen for while we're going through this one. The kick drum is leaning out in front of the snare for me, so it's a muffled sounding kick drum, which is cool, but it's kind of in front of the mix and the snare drum's behind it, not a lot of attack or presence on the snare. The guitar is at very high mid-rangey and they're sticking out. They're doing that thing that I was saying where, like, if this is our speaker, you know, we're looking at it like the tweeter's up here and the woofer's here or something, then we turn it to the side. The guitars are doing one of these where they're kind of like leaning out in front of the speaker, so if this was the speaker, the guitar is kind of hanging out up here and the vocals kind of back on the speaker thing. And again, this is a bat. Okay, here we go. Balancing here where the kick is a lot louder than the vocal.
I was afraid of the spear.
Maybe not a lot, it's a little bit louder than the vocal, or at least as loud. The hat pattern is very varied, but I kind of like it too. And like you said, the recording's very lo-fi, but you like the song. I think it's kind of interesting. Yeah, so that guitar being a little overcompressed and a little bit harsh is making it distracting from the vocal, and it makes the vocal feel buried because it's so much brighter too. Contrast is always a thing to think about. If you have something that's mid-rangey and pokey and bright and kind of loud and a little harsh, and it's going to make everything else feel dull. But if that thing's not there, then you have a different perception of what's left. So always be thinking about contrast, and the brightest thing is what our bar for bright is, and obviously dull on the other end of it. But that can happen within a mix too. Example of this really quick. If you listen to, this is on the other end of the spectrum musically, but if you listen to Bad Guy from Billie Eilish, so Bad Guy, Billie Eilish, and then listen to Break Up With Your Boyfriend from Ariana Grande, listen to those two back to back. Billie Eilish sounds like there's a pillow after it, or like there's a pillow on it, but only after you listen to Ariana Grande. It feels dark anyway, but after you listen to the Ariana Grande thing, one, Ariana Grande, if you listen to Billie first, Ariana Grande hurts your ears. And if you go back and listen to Billie after that, it feels like it just has a pillow on top of it. Neither one are wrong. They both sound great. But if you do the contrasting between the two, it's like, whoa, that's insane. So just something to think about. If you have that happening inside of your own mix, then something will feel harsh or bright or like too loud or painful, and then it'll make everything else feel dull and weak. So just a thought.
I'm not afraid of them anymore.
And here the guitars are sitting out in front of the vocals, making it hard to focus on the vocal. So if those came back and the vocals were left to be in the front a little bit more, it'd be easier to hear them. And then they're also stacked right on top of each other. I can't hear the low male very well because the female's right on top. Some kind of spreading or something like that would help. Again, I really like microshift. This song might not be right for too much of that sound, but just to like add some width to a sound and bring it up into it. Here we go. I think that song is super cool, to answer your question, by the way. I really like the song. Just needs a little bit of work on the recording. Like that guitar at the end was on the threshold of pain there. Just brightness wise and everything, but you could definitely make it more pleasing. Very cool though. Definitely dig it. All right, our next song is If Ever I Love Someone from Greg Shoemaker. And I might talk as we go through these so I can get to the rest of the ones that were posted. Here we go. Just so everybody knows, I got time for four more. And I got this one from Greg Shoemaker. I got Flandy Bob, Lucas, and Juan after that. So here we go. This is Greg Shoemaker. A lot of compression on this vocal, which is making it really spitty. It feels very scooped and compressed, and like the Blue Stripe 1176 kind of vibe, where it just kind of gets like a kind of spitty thing on it. So you could just kind of play with your attack and release times. It might be nice to let it breathe a little bit more, or do the compression in parallel. I know I'm reading your thing here that you're going for a more modern mixing style, which I think is really cool and an awesome thing to bring to Americana. But yeah, it's feeling a little scooped and overcompressed right there. So, like you need a de-esser, but I think if you just back off the compression, it might be more rounded.
But I've never had to wonder how I feel.
And that's that scratchiness thing that Tom's talking about.
If ever I love someone. First time I saw you, I knew with all of life's questions, you've answered one.
I like Tom's thing here about you know, making a group and hitting the bus compressor less hard, just kind of like bring it down or bring it up and find a sweet spot for that. I do that all the time. I have subgroups that are on a master fader, and I can see how hard I want to hit the mix bus with that fader, which is really great for this. The other thing is everything feels very scooped, so I'm not hearing the mid-range life of the guitars and everything. A lot of the information for sound for us is in the mid-range, and I've heard mastering engineers say like they'll rarely touch between like 500 and 1K in a mix if it's mixed well, because as soon as they do that, they can pull the mix apart. There's so much information that happens in that area, and you definitely want to pay attention to it. It's more important than the hyped top end or the exciting boomy low end, like punchy subs and all that stuff, or like crystal clear top. Mid-range is where the meat is. You could have something be lacking on those other two things and have it totally connect with somebody. But if you have the mid-range gone, you're missing the meat of the music, in my opinion. That's where so much information is. One thing I would suggest is getting like an Oratone or similar type speaker. I don't know if they make them anymore, but I had a Behringer version of the Oratone, because if you're buying a crappy speaker, why not buy the Behringer version? Zing! that's one thing that could be really useful. If you listen on like computer speakers or your phone, something like a small Bluetooth speaker, if you listen to this mix on there, you might feel like it was missing a lot, because the mid-range kind of is gone.
If I ever loved someone, sometimes I'm a cloud in the sky, sometimes a fish in the ocean, sometimes I'm a bird in a tree, baby, you set my wings in motion, sometimes I'm green or red, but mostly blue. Now I don't know what color I am today, just how I feel about you. If ever I love someone, maybe it's you.
I love the low end here. I think you've done a great job with that. And sometimes I think the vocal sounds great, and then it immediately goes into being overcompressed for me, but there's moments where the vocal tone is really, really good.
First time I saw you, I knew. Of all of life's questions, you've answered one. If I ever loved someone, well, sometimes I know right where I'm at, like a ship out on the sea with the stars for a map. But sometimes, baby, I don't know where I'm going. Got a bag full of dreams, just a hitching down the road.
Yeah, and then in that section too, it feels like it's just overcompressed and a little bit too loud on there. So yeah, it just feels like it's a little bit overhyped. And at first, sometimes those things can seem exciting and like you're breaking new sonic territory, new ground. But very quickly, you'll start to realize like it's sucking up dynamics and making it hard to hear other instruments and stuff like that. So try backing off some of that processing, but still go with your gut on the, you know, what's the new thing that I could bring to Americana and traditional songs? This, you know, thinking about what the multi-track for this sound probably sounds like, I would say you're probably adding a lot of excitement to it. And if you find a, I don't know if a middle ground's the right way, but like if you back off some of the things that might be taking away dynamics and some of the information that are like ears need to hear the instruments on it, I think you could get this pretty awesome and still maintain your vision of like what could I bring to the style.
Dreams, just a hitching down the road. If ever I loved someone, baby, it's you. The first time I saw you, I knew. Of all of life's questions, you've answered one. If I ever loved someone, if I
One other thing is like considering the content of the song as well. Like, this is a very vulnerable moment for the singer, and he's trying to be gentle and almost soothing to it. And using all of that compression and hype, it pulls away from what the song's goal is too. So that's something about this that's also kind of like rubbing me the wrong way. Is like you have to mix the song and what is the emotion that the person is trying to get across. Hyper compression, like having this strong kick bass vocal thing, those are all like anxiety or like highly energetic or strong, forceful. Those are like the kind of, you know, words that I would put on that sort of processing. And I'm hearing you're saying like it has a garage or bar feel to it. Yes, I can see that. But also like in this section, I feel like it's a love song. And I can't imagine, like, with that kind of vocal and that intensity, it doesn't feel soothing. It feels like someone's, like, forcefully saying, if I ever love someone, instead of, like, a calming, soothing way of saying it. And then, of course, in the chat, Luke has my back with the Spaceballs comment. You hoy to me? Nice. Spaceballs the movie. Merchandising, merchandising. All right, I sound like that today. Yeah, okay, cool. Very good stuff here. Smash the loudness too much into the master. Cool. Well, yeah, I hope it's helpful, GSS music. And again, I love that you're going for a new thing with the style. Keep going with that direction and seeing what you do. But also just consider like the emotion of the song, what the lyrics are trying to convey, what the singer's trying to convey, and you have to enhance those emotions. You can do that with modern mixing style things, as you're saying it, I think, and you could add something to the genre. I get what you're going after, for sure. And I think like you're on the way, too. So great job. Thanks for submitting. Hope that it helps. All right. Here we go. So Phantom. What did you say? It's a yoga singing. Yeah. Okay. Next song is Flandy Bob. My search feature is not working very well right now. Flynn. All right, that's not working. What's the name of the song again? It is Rips. Flandy, I can't find your song. I'm very sorry. Let me try this. Okay, if you're still here, let me know if I'm typing something wrong or if I copied it wrong from the chat. All right. Let's see what else we got here. Let's go to Did You Make It Home All Right? Uh-oh. Sterling Brunswald in the track or in the chat just called me a nerd. Said I better be helping you guys. Yikes. All right, let's see. Hope your dreams come true. This is from Gunno. Good to see you, Sterling. Here we go.
I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry for the failure I've been. You're saying nothing. Your silence tells me what you really mean.
Okay, first thing so far, the vocals on the intro are very, very loud and spread out in a phasey kind of way, like there's a lot of microshift or something like that applied to it. Just watch out for that. And then in terms of the level, this can happen when you are mixing very, very loud. So if you had your speakers cranked up, it might not have sounded that out of balance to you. So check this at a low level if you're working on speakers, if you're working on headphones. Very hard to get balanced things right when you're new to it on headphones. Again, just turn the volume down and see if you're getting enough of each instrument. Here we go from there. Oh, that synth, there was a note that conflicted with the vocals on the intro too, and then the rhythm was off a little bit as well. I would, if it's a software instrument, consider lowering the decay or the release time on that synth and make it a little bit more staccato. That might help it fit better rhythmically with what was going on in the guitar on the left speaker.
I knew you. I really thought that you were the one.
Yes, Martin. Coming soon. You know, Martin, you should ask Sterling about that. So through here, I'm not getting a lot of the snare, which is necessary to feel that backbeat. And then the drums feel like they're missing a lot of top end, not hearing too much definition in the rhythm. The vocals are so loud that they're drowning everything as well. So those definitely have to come back in the mix a bit.
Thank you.
Ah, you're right. You're right. I'm listening to the wrong song. All right. Well, Tom said all the stuff on this one. Let me click on the right song. Thank you, Luke. Here we go. A lot of 160 in the guitars right there.
Did you make it home all right? Did you lose yourself last night? Did your blood turn into tonic water? Did your heart get thrown in the gutter? Remember yesterday when nothing went your way? Your man threw you out of town.
Cool. Okay, so just gonna pause there. So I agree with a lot of what Tom's saying already, but I just saw your comment. You got some new studio monitors and you're getting used to them. I feel like this is close. When I listen to some references, they sound much more compressed in this mix. There might be a few things that poke out here and there, but I'm trying to get a good balance between everything and make the low end feel solid. So I'll check out the low end in a second, but you're saying biggest thing to me is this doesn't sound like a record when I compare it to some references. Any thoughts are appreciated. So the guitars, the low, mid, and the guitars is just kind of like going, the 160 is just doing like a, that's kind of what I'm hearing that's resonating. And it almost sounds like a feedback thing. If you're familiar with like live sound feedback at that volume, you just hear like a, like build up. That's what I'm hearing in those guitars. So they need to have some of that low mud stuff, you know, either removed, or you need to bring some presence to it and do some boosting EQ to try and get the tilt of that EQ a little bit more balanced. And then the other thing I've heard so far is the vocals are very loud, which is probably what's making this not feel like a record yet as well. So between like the lack of clarity and definition in between the actual like notes of the guitar and the vocal, those are two things I'm hearing so far. So here we go.
Your father slipped and let you down. You tried to burn your wedding gown. Now you're stuck with a bottle left to drown. Remember yesterday when nothing went your way. Did you make it home? Did you make it home? All right. Did you make
Compression overall is something to look at here too. We can kind of check that out right on this break here. So one, I'm listening to the snare sound, and then on the break, listen to the consonant when the vocal comes back in. So the compressor, the attack was set in a way that like it took a second for it to kick back down, and everything was like loud for a brief moment and then like buckled in really quick. So watch out for just over compression.
Did you make it home? You're digging yourself a hole at 23.
Some kind of low mid-ish stuff like 300-ish in the vocal as well, just kind of clouding it up.
Did you make it home? Did you make it home? All right. Did you make it home? All right. Did you make it home? Did you make
Things are feeling very exciting through all that. The you can hear the transients from like the snare and stuff just escaping that compression, either the mix bus compression or the drum bus, wherever you have, or snare, wherever you have it. The attack is set in such a way that you're letting the transient pop through, but it's so fast that it just feels like a tick escapes the speaker kind of a thing. So I'd play with those compression settings. And also, if you need to hit it this hard, powerful songs come from dynamics and like big hits and all of that stuff. The excitement of something that feels compressed is usually from parallel compression. So that's something to think about on there. I don't know, like, I'm trying to think of a good reference for you to watch on the site, and Michael Brower's videos are amazing for this. And Tom mentions Brower here about how he controls the VCA to play with the parallels and all of that to make that feel good. His setup is something that's so complex that it's like, I feel like you have to get the concept of parallel compression in a simple way before you start looking at this multi-bus parallel thing that is going on. But you can check that out for sure. Andrew Shep's rear bus technique is very much the same thing. It's just he's using one chain versus Michael using, you know, multiples across the different stereo buses. But yeah, I think parallel compression would help you get the excitement that you're looking for without getting the compressed, tight, squeezed feeling, which would help you make it sound more like a record, as you put it. Here we go. Almost sounds like these drums are programmed and the velocity set very low on this fill here. I would expect that drum fill to be much louder, but it sounds like it's really pulled back compared to when the downbeat hits. I'd like that fill to be loud to make it exciting. The kick drum's still loud. Not sure if you're the producer either, but when he goes to this halftime thing on the crash there, the guitars, if I were producing, I would suggest that they do something to also mimic the feel of that. So like the one and a two pause, pausing on the down or on the backbeat of those things, I think would tie the drums to the guitars better, or the guitars to the drums rather. Because right now it feels like the drums go like to this weird halftime thing with the pause, but the guitars don't follow, so they're just pushing through. Just a thought. That's a taste thing. Wait for it. Wait for it. Nice. Okay. Sterling said, this is the hook that I sang to my new speakers over the last few months. That's true. And it took them long enough, but they're here now. So, okay. Yeah. More on that coming soon. I do have to edit together the video of the whole process of the thing from like tearing the room down to the end of it. Okay. Going back. So yeah, I think I commented on everything through that. Lucas, nice job on this overall. And I think with the monitors, let me know in the comments if you listen loud or quiet. Some of the low mid stuff I actually don't hear at lower volumes. When I was kind of like rocking my volume up and down on that. So let me know on that. Cool. All right, moving on. I hope that was helpful. And this is going to be our last one for today. This song is called Sugar from Juan. Here we go.
In a cause of about times, you say in our tears a broken promise, a peaceful stupid. Well, can you try? In a curse of about times, a sweaty our feet will soon then rise. Never fits and never combine.
Okay, awesome job. I have a side note for you, and that is check out this band called As Tall as Lions. You would absolutely love this if that is your song. And maybe you know them already, but it reminded me of a track off of the record, You Can't Take It With You, I think is the name of it. Yeah, such a great band. Such a great band. Anyway, that reminded me of that, and very cool. Okay, so a couple thoughts on this. There's a lot of low-mid mud in the bass guitar. I felt like that was kind of eating things up a little bit. The vocals sitting behind the snare. Overall, the snare is a little bit loud. I can see why you would want the snare just a little bit in front of the vocal for a track like this. So that might be kind of cool. The awesome guitar that's happening at 120, that like middly, middly, middly thing, that tapping guitar part at 120 is sitting right on top of the vocal in the center. It might be cool if you pan that off a little bit so that we can still focus on the lyric and the vocal and yet still have that guitar, and maybe automate it down or back once the vocal comes back in. The football chords that come in shortly after that, same thing, right in the middle on top of the vocal, make some space, move them over a little bit. The acoustic guitars sound awesome, and I think that they could be up a little bit on the choruses. The bridge section, I felt like, was the same level as the rest of the song. Overall, the entire mix felt a little bit compressed and loud. I would go for a little bit more dynamic, come down a little quieter on the bridge, and then it would let that last chorus just explode, just building up out of it. The last chorus, like, make it a scene change. So I've talked about this before on the show, where if we think about the sections of the songs as the sections of the song as different scenes in a movie, how do you dress those up and how do you transition from one to the next and keep it interesting throughout the arc of the story, if you will. So the chorus could come down, it could get a little smaller, it's like down and intimate, and then blowing up into the biggest thing that's happened yet, our grand Michael Bay finale on the last chorus. That kind of idea. So just something to look at. But overall, I really love the song. I'd say just make some room in the center, a little less compression overall, let the track breathe more, have some dynamics to it. You don't have to master it. Just go for a great balance and everything. And I think that that's going to help some of the tones, because again, it, like, all of that compression stuff just makes things feel really angsty and doesn't let the music breathe. It distracts us from the vocal, and it just kind of makes everything important. And not everything is important. Not all the time, anyway. That's what I got for that one. But great song, and I really enjoyed it. And definitely check out As Tall As Lions. I think you'd like that band a lot. I can't remember how their mixes sound. It's been a while since I listened, but I might go back now, because I really love that band, and that made me think of them. Cool. Neil has a great comment in there. Cool. Thank you guys very much. Yeah, it's Sterling, great comments. Smokin', Martin, Sterling, Neil, Angel, everybody, Jeff, Luke, Tony, thank you guys so much for hanging with me until the end here. We did it. We went 2.5 hours. Good stuff. As always, just amazing stuff on Mixtank here. I'm amazed every week. It's so fun. So I will see you guys again in 2 weeks for the next Mixtank Online. 2:30 p.m. Eastern, and don't forget, Fab will be on this Friday, 2:30 p.m., mixing the Motown recreation from Puremix. I'll show you guys that. If you haven't seen this video, watch it before Friday, and then show up Friday for this live stream, because it's insane. So this is the video, recreating the sound of Motown with Louis Cato, and you can watch the entire tracking thing. And then come in Friday, he's going to mix it live on camera, so you can haggle him while he does it. But it's really a really fantastic video. I learned a lot from it, and it's fascinating to, like, hear them talk about how they used to do things at Motown. And Fab interviewed one of the original Motown engineers, Bob Olson. Bob gave him a lot of tips, including shredding a bunch of newspaper and stuffing it in the kick drum. So definitely tune in for that. That'll be Friday, 2:30 p.m. Guys, until then, thank you again for tuning in and for submitting your mixes. Very fun, and I hope that you found it useful, and I'll see you next time. Bye.